Tomorrow is the 1st of July, and Canada is celebrating the 150th birth anniversary of its formation. And there are celebrations all over the country, from the capital to all parts of the world, of the country. And it's indeed a moment to thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for the blessings of peace and security that we have here. And especially, you know, for us, the issue of openness towards the immigrants and the minorities. Most of the immigrants and the refugees here indeed realize, you know, that this is a moment that we have to thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that this country has accepted them and given them relatively, I would say, equal opportunity. However, while we go, you know, through these celebrations of the birth anniversary of Canada, two things are worthy of our consideration. Number one, especially we as a Muslim minority, we always have to keep in mind that Canada was not always the same. You know, the history of Canada is not only always, you know, bright and shining. There have been very dark stages and pages of this history of our country. You know, the our generation itself, we have seen the change in the attitudes, even at the federal government level, against the minorities. You know, you hear about the story of the imposing of head tax on the Chinese before, you know, a couple of generations before. You look at the time when the Japanese Canadians, even those who were born here, where, you know, they went through this process of internment during the Second World War. And so the positive change that we see in the country these days, these are good things. These are moments of, you know, thanking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for it. But this is where our responsibility comes in. We have to be vigilant to make sure that the positive changes are there to stay. And not only to be vigilant, but we have to play our own role as citizens of this country in having our, you know, our participation in the socio-political arena, whether it is from the school board levels to the municipal levels, or from the federal, provincial levels to the federal levels. At different levels, of course, there are issues of, you know, sense of responsibility that we should have when we embark on that path. But this is where we have to realize, number one, that, you know, vigilance is important, and keeping the pressure is also important, and that can only happen if we are involved in this process. The second point of reflection, while we celebrate the 150th birthday of Canada, is not to forget the First Nations of Canada. Remember, unlike Europe, our situation here is different. The British, the French, the Irish, the Italians, who came much, much before us, they are immigrants or generations and descendants of immigrants. The original inhabitants of this land are the First Nations. You know, the people who are technically, according to the legal language, they are still known as Indians. And that is not, this is something that we have to keep in mind. It was interesting that in early May of this year, as part of the York Region Interfaith Advisory Group, you know, I'd been invited with other faith leaders to visit Georgina Island First Nations, which is just about an hour from here in north, and you take a short ferry, 10 minutes, and that island, which is actually an Indian reserve. And the whole purpose was for us to go and visit them and to learn from them the history of the First Nations. And it was indeed a very, you know, informative trip to know about what happened. We have been hearing things, you know, here and there. And this is where we come to realize that those who are the First Nations of this land, if we really want to see who are the people who belong to this land, it is the First Nations. It is these natives or the Indians, as we call them. And, you know, they have suffered in different ways. And they are still suffering now. Yes, the Canadian government eventually came around to realize that this is a problem which has to be faced. And, you know, it was good that the government finally decided to form what is known as the Truth and Reconciliation Commission, which went around, you know, after their studies and survey. They, you know, issued the report in 2015. And we hope that the Canadian government, you know, fulfills those recommendations given by that commission. The most tragic part for the First Nations of Canada is this issue of residential schools. In mid-1800s, you know, the government decided to form residential schools where they would forcefully take the people from the First Nations tribes by force, put them in the residential, you know, schools, and when they will, after many years, go back, they wouldn't even be able to communicate with their parents because they don't know the language. Means within that one generation there, language gap, cultural gap, and these are the words from the Truth and Reconciliation Commission, the report, just one paragraph from that. These residential schools were created for the purpose of separating Aboriginal children from their families in order to minimize and weaken family ties and cultural linkages and indoctrinate children into a new culture, the culture of the legally dominant Euro-Christian Canadian society. The schools were in existence for well over 100 years. Children were abused physically and sexually, and then died in the schools in numbers that would not have been tolerated in any school system anywhere in the world. And unfortunately, it's not only the government, even the religious institutions were part of this zulm. And it says, Roman Catholic, Anglican, United, Methodist, and Presbyterian churches were the major denominations involved in the administration of the residential school system. And this is where we have to realize that, you know, as immigrants or children of immigrants in this part of the world, we cannot ignore the plight of the First Nations of this land. Let us learn about our own country and what is going on, and to look at the challenges that they face even now. You know, one of the things that I would like to share with you, and there is many, many more things that I learned there, that the lady who was making the presentation, she just talked about, you know, the schooling system. They only have an elementary school on that island because they don't have the resources. You know, the reserve areas are reserve area. Nobody, the governments don't finance anything. And so she said, when my children grew up, and the issue is to now send them to the high school. High school is just there across the ferry, 10 minutes, you know, ferry ride. But she could not send them there because her address was of the reserve. And because her address is of the reserve, Indian reserve, you know, Ontario government's schooling system will not accommodate them. When they go and complain, the provincial government says, you know, all the agreements and treaties signed between the Indian tribes and the Canadian government was done with the federal government. You go to them. Whereas education system is a provincial jurisdiction. So we are not responsible for you or for your children. Until this lady says that I had to go and buy a house on the other side of the island, you know, to have this address there so that, you know, my children can go to the high school. This is something that we take for granted. Immigrants, children of immigrants, even people working here with work permit don't have that problem. You know, just think about it, and this is where, you know, we talk about zalim and mazlum. We talk about, you know, being awunan, you know, supporters of those who are mazlum. This is one case, right in our backyard. We don't know, maybe we are actually living in the land of those people. And this is something we have to think about. If the government, in the past, for 100 years, established residential schools to make them civilized according to their own view, why not provide schoolings for them now? And that's where you see all these issues of, you know, suicide rate among the youths in the native tribes. And this is where something we have to think about, and we should not only be, you know, taking the benefits of this society, we also have to look at other minorities who are not really being taken care of in the way it should be. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us the wisdom and the courage to fulfill our duty in the best of the manner. In ahsan al-hadith, kitab Allah al-aziz, bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. والعصر إن الإنسان لفي خسر إلا الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات وتواصوا بالحق وتواصوا بالصبر أعوذ بالله من الشيطان اللعين الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله الذي لا إله إلا هو الحليم الكريم غافر الذنب وقابل التوبة وهو الغفور الرحيم ونشهد أن لا إله إلا هو العطوف للعباد بجوده والعواد على المذنبين بحلمه ونشهد أن محمدا نبيه وحبيبه سيد المرسلين وشفيع المذنبين ورحمة للعالمين صلى الله عليه وآله الداعين إلى سبيل الله بالحكمة والموت الحسنة قادة الأمم وأولياء النعمة ومعدن الرحمة عصيكم عباد الله بالطوبة ما صلف من ظنوبكم. In the issue of dealing with the minorities, unfortunately, even the Muslim countries have not lived up to the standards set by Islam. Once Amir al-Mu'mineen Ali bin Abi Talib alayhi salatu wasalam is a Khalifa and the ruler of the Muslim world at that time with his capital in Kufa, you know, went for a walk in the bazaar, in the marketplace. And of course, as a Khalifa, he doesn't go alone. Other officers were with him. And he noticed an old man, you know, by the side of the road there, you know, begging. And Amir al-Mu'mineen looks at that person and turns to his officers and he says, "Ma hava." It's interesting to see he didn't say, "Man hava." He didn't say, "Who is this person?" His question was, "What is this?" In a sense, Ali is saying that what I see is not acceptable in an Islamic system. That a blind old man begging on the street. And so one of the officers, kind of trying to justify, says, "Haza Nasraniyun." Or Ali, he's a Christian. قَدْ كَبُرَ وَعَجَزَ. You know, now he's become old. He's no more capable of contributing to the society. And he has become blind. And this is where Ali turns to them, that you have not been fair to him. اِسْتَعْمَلْتُمُوهُ حَتَّى إِذَا كَبُرَ وَعَجَزَ. You used him. He was probably an ironsmith before. you used him, used his talent, and he, you know, contributed to the society as long as he could. Now that he has become old, incapable of doing any more, taraktumuhu, you just leave him alone? Go and include his name in Baytul Mal, Baytul Mal of the Muslimin, ratiban, that he should regularly, monthly allowance should be given to him to take care of it. Salawat Pandey Akbar. And this is where we have to think about that, you know, when we talk about Islam, and to say we are Muslims is one thing, really to live up to that expectation and the standard that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has set for us is not that easy. And compare that attitude, that idea that Amir al-Mu'mineen was presenting with the Muslim world at the moment. Look at these rich Gulf states. They don't only send the citizens of other countries out and expel them, they even expel the camels of that country. Look at the low level that Muslims have reached to. Is the camel Qatari or Saudi? How do you know the difference there? You know, and this is where we come to realize that, you know, when we say, oh Allah, what is going on? Allah will say, I have blessed you with everything. But you have not fulfilled this side of the bargain. And this is where, you know, look at how they treat foreign workers, even Muslims. There is no security, there is no rights. A fellow works for 45 years there, and then, okay, Khuda Hafiz. There is nothing there at the end. Look at the situation in Pakistan as far as the treatment of the minorities is concerned. You know, when we talk about the issue of security of life, peace in getting going around in the marketplace, or security in your masjid and Imam Bargas, nothing. The twin blast in Parachanar, and look at the lowest level that these takfiri forces have reached to. First, they have the blast, and when others who are going to help those victims, then they have the second blast. So they wait. They wait for the helpers, whether they are the, you know, emergency personnel or, you know, ordinary citizens, then they have the second blast. Look at the situation in Quetta. In the last week, more than 100 Shias have died. And the whole country celebrated Eid with the government not even saying anything about it. No official statement about it. Even the media has been kind of, you know, busy with Eid celebrations. And this is where we come to realize that, you know, when we see bala and fitna in the Muslim world, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, it is not because of me, it is because of your own doing. Unless you change yourself, nothing is going to change. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you know, protect the Muslim ummah, bring them to the right path, especially the followers of Ali bin Abi Talib, wherever they are, inshallah. Allahumma salli ala Sayyid al-Mursaleen wa Shafi al-Mudhanibin, Nabiyyina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam. وعلى إمام المتقين وعمير المؤمنين علي بن أبي طالب صلوات الله عليه وعلى سيدة نساء العالمين سيدتنا فاطمة بنت رسول الله صلوات الله عليها وعلى سيد الشباب أهل الجنة الحسن المجتبى والحسين الشهيد بكربلاء عليهم الصلاة والسلام وعلى أئمة المسلمين علي بن الحسين ومحمد بن علي وجعفر بن محمد وموسى بن جعفر وعلي بن موسى ومحمد بن علي وعلي بن محمد والحسن بن علي عليهم الصلاة والسلام اللهم صل على مولانا الحجة بن الحسن صاحب العصر والزمان ما أحيا صار البدء والطغيان هادم أبنية الشرك والنفاق حاصد فر البغ والشقاق صلوات الله وسلامه عليه وعلى آباء الكرام ما اتصلت الليالي والأيام اللهم عجل فرج وصح المخرج واكحل ناظرنا بنظرة منا إليه واجعلنا من المستشهدين بين يديه اللهم اجعلنا ممن يذكر فتنفعه الذكرى إن الله يعمر بالعدل والإحسان وإيتاء ذي القربى وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر والبغي يعظكم لعلكم تذكرون